Hey guys, in this session I want to talk about how understanding the Bible as one story can impact the way we understand the details of the story. And I know that there are some questions that come up with that, and so I want to address those questions first and take some time to talk about Scripture presenting one master narrative. So some questions that come up, first of all, would be this. Can and should we see the Bible as one grand narrative? Like, is that the way God wants us to see the Bible, or is that superimposing something on Scripture that's not really there? Another question then would be in follow-up, if the Bible does present a grand narrative, in what ways does it do that? And I think we would all acknowledge that the Bible is made up of individual books, 66 individual books combined to tell one overarching story. And so in looking at that, I don't want to communicate that we're not looking at individual books as independent pieces of literature. So for example, if I'm studying the book of Genesis, I want to treat that as a literary unit because it is a literary unit. And Moses wrote that under the inspiration of Scripture. But what I find so amazing is that these independent or individual, I should say, literary units called books of the Bible, combined, they also present a unified, cohesive whole. And so I'll be talking about that. Well, in follow-up too is, what impact should understanding the Bible as one story, what impact should that have on the way I interpret the details? Should I carry my understanding of the whole to the individual texts, or should I let the individual text impact my understanding of the whole, or is it both of those? And then finally, are there any words of caution that I might want to remember when I'm interpreting the Bible based on it being one meta story? And so I'm going to begin with this. I want to try to give some evidence to show that the Bible presents an overarching narrative. And the first way of doing that is showing that there's a structure of narrative that the entire Bible presents. So I'm going to give you some quotes here from different individuals just to make the point that this doesn't come from one theological perspective. Okay, so this first quote comes from Leland Ryken. Leland Ryken is a literary expert. That's his field of study. And he says, quote, "The Bible possesses an overarching narrative unity. Taken as a whole, the Bible tells a story that has a beginning, a middle, and an end." That's Leland Ryken from a literary perspective. Elliot Johnson comes at it from a dispensational biblical studies perspective. And he says this, "The canon of Scripture consists of 66 books, yet the combination tells a complete story. This story has a beginning, middle, and end." And so you have a literary expert, and then you have a dispensational theologian. Well, we can go further and see that someone from a covenant theology background sees it the same way. And I think this is interesting to show that it's a literary expert, a dispensational theologian, and a covenant theologian. This is area of commonality or common ground. So it's not isolated to one perspective on Scripture. And so N.T. Wright says this, "Israel's ancient scriptures are framed with a narrative, an unfinished narrative of a certain shape and type. When you read the Old Testament, you're still left with a sense that this story is supposed to be going somewhere, but that it hasn't gotten there yet." And so again, just an argument that the Bible presents an overarching story, and the entire Bible is necessary to see the plot line come to a place of completion at the end. Michael Goheen says, "Speaking of the Bible as one story is not to say that it's like a single volume with a tightly woven storyline with no loose ends. Yet in its basic overall structure, it does tell an overarching story." And this is what I find fascinating about Scripture, is that we're never going to be at a place where we've studied all the details to where we've seen everything that could be seen. And so we see an overall plot line being developed. We see an overarching storyline. But as Goheen points out, there are loose ends and there are other subplots and subthemes that are being developed. And it's just a masterwork that came from God. So it's absolutely amazing. So you have literary structure that's one of those aspects. Now, I'm going to build on that a bit further here. So these authors that I quoted, they talked about the Bible having a beginning and a middle and an end. I want to develop that a bit further, and I want to use some literary features that you may be familiar with. A narrative has a beginning, and we call that a setting. and the setting introduces you to the ideal or the way things are supposed to be, and it also introduces you to the protagonist or the good guy. And so, for example, if I'm reading a novel, in the first scene, I'm going to find out who the hero is and the way things are supposed to be. I'll actually transfer it to a movie scene because I have two daughters and we've watched Cinderella, I don't know, hundreds of times. The first scene in Cinderella is how Cinderella is born into this royal family and she's going to grow up as royalty, and one day she herself will inherit royalty. Well, that's the setting of the story. It shows you the protagonist, Cinderella, and it shows you the ideal, the way things are supposed to be. So you have the setting of a story. That's significant. The next sequence or next feature in sequence of narrative is what we call the initial conflict. That's the problem that upsets the status of the beginning. The beginning shows you the way things are supposed to be. The initial conflict threatens the status of the beginning. It threatens to mess things up that are perfect in the beginning. And if you watch Cinderella, you'll find that the next scene is where Cinderella's mother passes away and then her father passes away. And everything hopeful begins to unravel. And now you're left wondering, is she going to inherit royalty or is someone else going to have her place? And that is the plot line that is traced throughout much of the narrative that follows. We call that the conflict development. And we're waiting to see who's going to win. Is the protagonist going to find fulfillment of their desires and their plan? Or is the enemy, the antagonist, going to win? And that carries you through a story until you come to a climactic scene, whether that's written or something that you watch. And that climactic scene is called the resolution. And in the resolution, the tension in the narrative breaks. Someone wins a decisive battle. And either the antagonist establishes their way of life and they win, or the protagonist comes into power. They win a decisive battle and things turn out to live happily ever after. In the story of Cinderella, at just the last moment, Cinderella breaks out of her castle cell and she runs down the stairs and she's there just in time to try on the glass slipper and ultimately to inherit royalty. That's the resolution. That's where the tension breaks in the narrative. Following that, you have what we call the epilogue. And the epilogue takes you back very similar to what you had in the setting. The ideal was in the beginning. Cinderella is supposed to be royalty. And when you come to the epilogue, Cinderella has found her place in royalty and it restores the status of the beginning. And it also shows you the results of the victory that came for the protagonist. Now, here's the thing. When you look at the biblical story presents an overarching meta-narrative, and it fits those features of a narrative. And I'm not superimposing that upon Scripture. I'm reading that out from Scripture. Scripture begins with a beginning. It begins in the beginning. God created the heavens and the earth. That's the setting. That's the ideal. And the way things God wants it to be, God being the protagonist, the way God wants things to be is that mankind would live in fellowship with God, representing God as His image. He made man and woman in His image. God wanted mankind to rule over the earth that God had created, so He gave them dominion. And God allowed them to exercise that dominion. And so you see Adam naming the animals that God brings in front of him. And everything is the way it's supposed to be. No death, no suffering, no sorrow, nothing to make them afraid. There's harmony between man and man, harmony between man and the animal kingdom, harmony between man and God. And God looked at that and He gave His crowning blessing and He pronounced those words, "It was very good." That's the ideal. And God's plan was, His desire is that mankind ruling the earth in His image and likeness would multiply and fill the earth. So the plan of God from the beginning was to fill the earth with people who know God and who worship Him as God and who extend God's kingdom over the entire earth. That's the beginning. I'm sure you're already tracking now and you would know that the initial conflict comes in Genesis chapter 3. And the serpent came along and said, "Yea, hath God said." He comes and he challenges the authority of God's word, and he presents a counter kingdom in opposition to God. And he seeks to elicit followers of himself instead of followers of God. And what you find as a result of that initial conflict is that the status of the beginning has been upset. Mankind was created to live in fellowship with God, and as a result of the fall, mankind was separated from God and sent out of the Garden of Eden. Mankind was supposed to live in dominion over all of the earth, including its creatures. And now mankind had submitted himself to the dominion of the creature, and ultimately to Satan, who was behind that creature. Mankind was supposed to live in harmony with the animal kingdom, and now there is disharmony between man and creation. Mankind was to live in harmony with the rest of mankind, and now there's disharmony among mankind, and you'll see that when Cain kills his brother Abel. Mankind was to live in fellowship with God, and now that's been broken. And God wanted an earth filled with people who knew him. But as we trace the biblical story, it's in fact the very opposite that takes place. And it was so bad that God hit the reset button on humanity, and he submersed the world in a flood, and he brought out of that Noah and his family to start again. And I'll talk about this in other tutorials, but when you follow this storyline, you see that God didn't give up on his plan. He announced that in Genesis 3 when he said the seed of the woman would crush the head of the serpent. Satan established a counter kingdom in opposition to God. And now the question is, who's going to rule the world? Who's going to have a kingdom on the earth? Is the earth going to be filled with people who know and worship God? Or is it going to be filled with those who are the seed of the serpent? And that takes us through the biblical story, wondering who is going to have their dominion. But God's plan was there in Genesis 3. The defeat of the serpent and Satan behind the serpent would come from the seed of the woman. And now we trace the plot line to see who's going to win. Is God going to have his kingdom on the earth, or is Satan going to rule the world? Who's going to win? And I'm not going to go, I really want to. I'm not going to go through all the stories because it would take way too long to do that. But you see this in all these climactic major events all the way through scripture. And so what I'll do is take you from the initial conflict to the resolution. The resolution is where there's a decisive victory that either vindicates the plan of the good guy or it vindicates the plan of the bad guy. Is Satan going to have his kingdom, or is God going to have his kingdom on the earth? Is God going to fill the world with people who worship him, or is Satan going to do that? And when we come to the climactic scene, it's in Revelation chapter 19. And Satan has brought his counterfeit into this place called the tribulation, where the Antichrist presents himself as God in the temple of God, claiming to be God. And he's doing miracles astounding all the peoples of the world. And yet the Lord Jesus Christ comes in judgment in Revelation 19 as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He binds that serpent of old, Revelation 20, who is Satan and the devil, and he throws him into a pit, and he sets up his kingdom on this earth for 1,000 years. And when that time is finished, he throws Satan into the lake of fire, and you come now to the epilogue of the story, and that is the results of the resolution, the happily ever after. And you find that the decisive victory that God won through the Lord Jesus brings in the resolution of the story, and it takes us back, get this, it takes us straight back to the beginning. You have mankind ruling and reigning on this earth in the fellowship and presence of God, harmony between man and man, harmony between man and the animal kingdom, and most significantly, harmony between man and God. John says repeatedly in Revelation 21 and 22 that God himself will be with them, that they will see his face, mankind in the presence of God again, God's kingdom on the earth, and the entire earth filled with people who know God and worship him as God. It's a beautiful scene. And just so we don't miss the parallels and the bookends of the biblical story, John tells us in Revelation that it's a new heaven and a new earth. And we find that the tree of life is present. He takes us back to the paradise of God on the earth and mankind living in perfect harmony with God. Now, I want to take a couple more minutes and I want to show you some things that are significant about this meta-narrative. When you're tracing the biblical story and the major themes, this is huge. You're looking at the bookends of the story because the setting shows you the ideal and the epilogue shows that you've come back to the ideal. And then you look at the initial conflict and you ask yourself, what was lost in the fall? Because that's what God is going to be at work in history to restore to mankind. And because of that, when we view salvation simply as our sins forgiven, our view of salvation is majorly limited because God's not done with salvation history until not only are our sins forgiven, not only do we have glorified bodies and we're in the presence of God, but we have a new heaven and a new earth, and everything is back as it was in the beginning. And so God's plan, found all the way back in Genesis, comes to fruition in Revelation 21 and 22. And what that does for us is it challenges us, first of all, with this sense of urgency to take the message to the world and urge them to align themselves with the protagonist, to exercise faith in the Lord Jesus so that they will be a part of God's eternal kingdom. It also reminds us of the amazing love and grace of God, because God went so far to restore mankind back to this that not only did he come to pay for our sin debt, but Jesus, because he came as a man and he resurrected as a man from the dead, Hebrews says he can bring many sons to glory. He's able to restore us to that which was there in the beginning. And so the metanarrative of Scripture then has those literary features that show us that it should be seen as one cohesive whole.